One of our favorite sponsors is back with us. Sunset Lake CBD. If you're looking for CBD that actually does what CBD is supposed to do, look no further than our friends over at Sunset Lake.
Let me break it down.
Break it down, Mel.
They're sustainably farmed, meaning they avoid pesticides and use sustainable farming practices to preserve the land for future generations. One. Two, farm to table. They ship the CBD products straight from their door in Vermont directly to your door wherever you're at.
Oh, that's cool.
And third party tested. They test everything with a third party to ensure quality, dosage, and safety.
You got to go over and check out sunsetlakecbd.com. They have so many products. Break it down for them, Apple.
Well, they've got some new stuff going on. Like they always had pre-rolls, but now they got really cool packaging for it. And you can get CBD pre-roll flights of all their flavors. You can get the heavy hitter flight that also throws in some of their Keef blunts. They have a new CBD recovery body lotion.
I'm excited about that.
Mm-hmm.
And what was the other?
The other one with arnica.
It's an extra strength muscle rub, 3,000 milligram with 5% lidocaine.
So look,
oh yeah, lidocaine.
If you're sore, this is the stuff you want to rub on your body to make those aches and pains go away. They even have CBD infused coffee, so you can have coffee without the little jitter that you get from caffeine, and you have it in the morning and you start your day off right. Your body feels lubricated. You're going to sleep good.
Yeah, and also they have, if you kind of forget to reorder, they've got subscriptions.
And they're giving the No Simple Road family 20% off.
20% off.
Put in the promo code NSR20 when you're checking out at sunsetlakecbd.com. You're going to get 20% off your entire order.
NSR20.
And don't forget those cute little gummy bears.
That's right. sunsetlakecbd.com. One of our favorite sponsors is back.
You know when something's really good?
Yeah.
Most of the time.
You want to keep it going on for as long as you can.
This is true. Yeah.
That's how we feel about Shop Tour Bus.
That is how we feel about Shop Tour Bus.
We are in love with Shop Tour Bus. They are a Grateful Dead inspired merchandise.
Creators.
Purveyors of the online lot and sometimes in person on lot.
This is true.
These aren't your regular, you know, that you get in the lot with the 13-point bolt, with the steely and everything like that. These are like cryptic little things you got to figure out. It's pictures inspired by lyrics that are the dopest thing. There's no words on it, so people have to guess. It always strikes up a conversation, and I'm wearing one of my favorites right now. I have so many of these. They are the most comfortable shirt. They'll keep you feeling awesome in the summertime when you're going and hitting the lot.
Which one is that? That is Scarlet Begonias, I'm guessing.
Yes.
Okay, cool. See, I had to guess. And check this out. They have been a sponsor of No Simple Road for going on 5 years, I think, or
yeah, that's,
more.
That's why I started it out that way.
And we have never met in person until today is the day that we are meeting Luke and the Roadies for the first time in person.
Yay!
So see, that's what happens. Grateful Dead family's dope. They're going to send you an all-over print box with all kinds of extras on the inside. Some of you are going to get a Miracle Grateful Dead bootleg cassette tape in your order, and you're getting free shipping from our family at Shop Tour Bus when you put in the promo code
NOSIMPLEROAD.
All one word when you're checking out. Go to shoptourbus.com and follow them on Instagram at shoptourbus.
And feel groovy.
Dead & Company's wrapping up tour this week, and you don't have to be sad. You know what? The Grateful Dead family is here. They're taking care of you. They're here in Portland at Fire on the Mountain. They're in Denver. Three locations here in Portland, two locations in Denver. You can go have a nice meal cooked by your very own Grateful Dead family in a loving, kind, and caring way when you're feeling nostalgic for the days gone by when John Mayer graced the stage with Bob Weir and they stood up there and sang you Althea or something else.
Truckin'
again.
Sugary.
Yeah. Then you don't have to feel sad anymore. You can go over to Fire on the Mountain and have some chicken wings, and it'll
or
be great.
You can also go to portlandwings.com and order yourself up some of their buffalo hot sauce, their soon-to-be famous spicy peanut sauce, lime cilantro sauce, or you can get a 3-pack and or some merch from Fire on the Mountain.
Hook yourself up with some socks. What are you going to say, Apple?
The thing I love about them is it's like going to a Dead show. They have all your comfort, your regulars and everything, but they make you go outside of your comfort zone and your boundaries by offering up monthly new sauces and specials, so they keep it live.
This is all truth that Apple just told. Not one piece of bullshit in there.
Uh-uh.
Well done, Apple. So, hey, check it out. Go to portlandwings.com, like Mel said, and follow them on Instagram at FOTMPDX. Or if you live in Denver, follow them at FOTMDenver. I guess you don't have to, like, live somewhere to follow them. You can follow either. You
follow them anywhere.
You could live in Colorado or Kansas or wherever the fuck. It doesn't matter. Just go check out Fire on the Mountain because it's the Grateful Dead family making you food and it makes you feel good. Makes your tum-tum feel good. They even have vegan options, man. Vegetarians because you guys are a bunch of hippies.
And they have FOTM brewing.
That's right. It is that time of year again. It's almost like Christmas, but it's in the summertime and it's when Fish Tour starts. And that's really a good time of the year.
That's how you judge like what goes on in the year.
Yeah.
Oh, it's Fish Tour, so
yep.
It's time to
party. And you know what?
Party
man?
On.
There are a lot of venues back east that those of us out west don't know, and vice versa. Most of us haven't
True
been on
that.
Tour like you dusty wooks out there. And here's the thing. When you're going to that new venue, you want to know what the hell's going on. You want to know where to sit. You want to know if the security is going to shake you down. See, even
yeah,
the
like
thought
at the Gorge.
Of it makes me stumble my words. Yeah, like at the Gorge. And
you got nervous just thinking about it.
You want to know what the bag policies are. All that stuff that you think about when you're going to a new venue. Well, you want to go to VenueLlama.com. I'm going to tell you why.
VenueLlama.
You want to know why?
Want to know why?
It is where live music why? Fans share helpful insider venue reviews and information based on their own experiences. This isn't bots, AI, or a bunch of paid jerk-offs writing reviews. This is real people, showgoers like you and me that know about stuff, that went to these venues, that are telling you, so now you got the lowdown and you're not a noob anymore. It's a place where pro showgoers can quickly review venues and exchange seriously helpful venue intel with one another. Head over to VenueLlama.com today and sign up for your free Llama account and start reviewing venues today. Yeah, reviews. That's the thing. They are in the Llama base. You can upload photos in the Llama gallery and add your favorite scene-friendly businesses, websites, or podcasts to the friend page. Yeah, that's the thing. You want to do this. You want to go to Venue Llama.
You absolutely do.
Become a Sherpa.
And don't forget about Venue Llama on YouTube. They have an incredible YouTube channel.
That's
with
right.
Lots of stuff going on.
And I heard tell that there is a Venue Llama podcast happening now.
Welcome to the podcast world, Venue Llama.
And I heard that there is going to be an Aaron Schaefer interview on the Venue Llama podcast as well.
What? Mm-hmm.
That's a thing that's happening. So there's a, you know, Venue Llama is
not
Venue just Llama. A web page. It is a whole universe to teach you, help you, Sherpa you up the mountain, if you will, of the new venue experience and giving you a full live music world to dive into. So go to VenueLlama.com, sign up today. What's up, everybody? If you're like me and you're trying to do better for yourself and what you eat in this new year, I have something really cool for you. Factor's delicious, ready-to-eat meals make eating better every day way easier. Wherever tomorrow takes you, be ready with pre-prepared, chef-crafted, and dietitian-approved meals delivered right to your door. You're going to have over 35 different options a week to choose from, including keto, calorie smart, vegan, and veggie, and more. And there's even more to enjoy with over 55 nutrition-packed add-ons that help make your weekly meal planning even more delicious. What are you waiting for? Sign up and save. They've done all the math. Factor is less expensive than takeout, and every meal is dietitian approved to be nutritious and delicious. So here's what you got to do. Head to factormeals.com/NoSimpleRoad50 and use the code NoSimpleRoad50 to get 50% off your first box and 2 free wellness shots per box while subscription is active. That's code NoSimpleRoad50 at factormeals.com. Take all the guesswork out of trying to do the right thing for your body. Fuel up easy and fast. Go check out Factor. Time. It really is. It's the end of something wonderful and different and cool. Like, this weekend is the final Dead & Company shows. That's just the way it is.
The end of an era.
Yeah. Hey, now, No Simple Road family, welcome to another episode of
welcome
No Simple
back.
Road. This is Aaron.
This is Apple.
And Mel and, over here.
And Darwin, fresh from his bath, mm-hmm. laying on his
looking
bed
all
over there.
Dapper and everything. He actually changes color when he gets a nice bath.
So do you, dude.
So many, so much hair came off of him during his bath. And then I brushed him before his bath. And then you brushed him after his bath. I'm convinced that we could have had three more Darwins with those three. Yeah,
we should make pillows out of that.
We should.
Or make like dolls. Or say, did you see at the country fair? There's like two booths. It looks like it's like dust bunnies and wool that's wrapped.
I
and they make
that.
Figure. I was thinking that when all that hair was flying, it's like if we collected that hair, we could make little pets.
That'd be
stuff.
Adorable.
It's like bound, and it would be adorable.
You're adorable.
Darwin's like, I want my cut. Yeah.
So yeah,
you'll get
man.
Treats, Dar.
This weekend, like right now, today's Friday. The final Dead & Company shows are going down right now. Like
as we,
it
speak.
Is a. It's weird. It really is. Like it was a.
I don't know if I believe it though. Like sure, maybe you know John Mayer won't be you know.
Yeah, as far as that,
but it's still gonna go on. So like, I don't feel that weird about it. I'm like, okay, it's
no, we're gonna see other
there's gonna be other
renditions.
I'm gonna make a prognostication, right? You are not gonna see this big of a
no
Dead & Company ish thing again.
No, I believe it'll be more like we used to like Further, Rat Dog, stuff like that, touring around with members.
Yep. Or I could be totally wrong and next year there's a stadium tour. So who knows? And nobody knows. But you know what? It is sad, man, in a way. It's bittersweet, I'll say.
Oh, okay.
I feel like it's time. Like this thing has done what it needed to do.
You mean the whole Dead & Company machine or just this?
The John Mayer iteration of Dead & Company that like it's now done what it was supposed to do. It turned on a whole new generation of deadheads.
It surely did that.
It exposed a whole shit ton of people to the music that would have never paid attention to it.
And it really reinvigorated a lot of deadheads
businesses
and like and new ones. The new things that have come out that have made tons of cash because of this
I'm
new
thinking
inspiration.
Of people like Nola.
Yep.
Nola Dead or Holy Moly Mischief or Thunder Shout or
Online Ceramics.
Online Ceramics. All those guys that are, you know.
And more that we don't know.
Bosses in the lot.
Yeah.
And like all that is just, where's it going? I remember this thought when Jerry passed. Because there was a whole economy that happened that was
around
following
that.
The Dead when I was on tour. And that was like, I remember the day that Jerry died, Mike Whitaker knocked on my door at my apartment. We were between tours and he was crying and he was like, dude, Jerry died. And he came in and sat down at the little weird table in the budget suites in Vegas. And, gross. And the first thing I said to Mike was, what's going to happen to all the deadheads?
They survived.
And he was like, they're going to go to Fish Tour. And I mean, if that's what happens, great. You know, that's cool. That's what I did.
Where was the Sleeping Dead community pre-John Mayer?
The Sleeping Dead community, like when Jerry passed, a lot of people went to...
I'm not even going back that far. I'm saying like...
It fanned out.
How long has Dead & Company been playing?
Since 2015.
2016.
Okay, 16. So from 2014 to in the 2000s,
well,
was happening
we
then?
We were seeing Further. We were seeing Rat Dog. We were going to Dark Star shows.
They spread out. They figure it out. Like, yeah, if deadheads are not one thing, but they are revolutionary, they are carry their inspiration in whatever pocket they go in.
Some would say it moves them brightly.
It moves them brightly.
And they fanned out and a lot of them settled in places like the Pacific Northwest and all yep. over California. And then when the internet came along and you start seeing more and more shops popping up on eBay and online and stuff too.
Right.
Because people are going to be sad. People will be sad and they're going to want some merch and they're going to want to be around other deadheads. And so other deadheads will pick up that call.
But you're also going to see bands filling the void. Bands like Garcia Birthday Band, Sunstroke Serenaders, Darkstar Orchestra, Grateful Shred. Those kind of bands are now going to rise up. Because the dead community now needs a home. And those
J-Rad still out
right,
there.
And those local bands are going to become the meeting place for deadheads in the community.
And they're going to congregate like Skull and Roses.
Yeah,
going
absolutely.
On and carrying that on and getting bigger every year.
So we went to Skull and Roses back in April. And we had so many episodes in the can when we left that it's taken us pretty much this long to get this content out to all of you.
So from April to July.
To be fair to the people that we had already recorded with, to put them out in order to get this content out. So this, what you're going to get today on No Simple Road, it actually is serendipitous being that Dead & Company is completing their run shows now. And
anytime we've ever done this in the past where we've had to wait for a long time for something to come out, when we end up putting out, inevitably it's the best time to do it.
Yeah
it drops at the right moment.
It really does. And I feel this is exactly that moment. Like, it was a huge dream and desire for us to have Bill Walton on the show.
Yep.
Being that we're from Portland, being that he's a huge deadhead for most of his life, and the fact that we were able to meet, and I wouldn't say we talked to him.
He talked to us.
He definitely talked
to us. He told me to be quiet. That's about all I got.
He's like, hold on, Aaron, come on.
He is the most enthusiastic deadhead that there is. You can't compete with this enthusiasm.
Wait a minute. Bill Walton is the epitome of a headlight on a northbound train.
Yes. If you didn't know what that meant, look up Bill Walton.
Yeah, and you'll see his picture next to that lyric in the Grateful Dead songbook. This episode is our... Bill Walton talking with us at us.
Yeah.
And also our conversation with Latin Dead.
The Latin Dead.
Man.
Our new family.
So we were joined in these by
Dennis, Tammy, and Augie from
Tales from the Green Room.
Thank you.
From Mount Tam Media.
That's right.
That is another podcast that is out there doing their thing. They sat down with us and shared these interviews with us. And, I have to say that I was with Bill Walton. It was like midday. We're backstage. Mel goes and finds Bill Walton. He comes over. It's time to do our Bill Walton conversation. And I thought, silly me, that we were going to have an interview. And that is just not what went down.
I don't think Bill Walton does interviews. He does.
No, I've seen him do it.
He does monologues. He does commentary, but not really too many question answer things.
And you know what, man? What a gracious, sweet human being. Like, knew all of our names the next day.
Yep.
Knew all of the band's names. You'll hear him in this just peeling off the names of all the people in the bands he was watching.
I meet somebody and they tell me their name, and 30 seconds later, I have no fucking clue who they are.
He's a special human being.
Yes.
Seeing him and his wife together and how they dance with the fans, and I don't mean literally dance. I just mean the way that they maneuver in and out. And, you know, like Aaron said, I went to go find Bill Walton. We just wanted to make sure that, you know, he knew where to come find us and all that. And as I was approaching Bill, there was some fans that kind of like cut me off and went to talk to him. But I had seen his wife and I was like, no, I want to ask her permission. I want to talk to her. I'll leave that alone, you know? And the way that they just take care of each other and the love that he has for her, he just, what a special and inspiring couple they are.
And somebody that's fired up to begin with. This conversation that you're about to hear is a testimony to the energy of Skull and Roses as well.
Oh, yeah.
Because you can hear how excited Bill is to be at Skull and Roses.
That's what I was glad to see, too. Like, meeting him in person and seeing the stature of him and that his voice, his tallness, when he spread his arms out behind us when we took the picture,
my gosh.
Like his arm outreach is like 2-3 people on each side, and his arms are, I mean, like he could hug the world.
Dude, he should have played basketball when he was younger.
He said to me when we were about to take that picture, he's like, Mel, stand in front of me. You're not going to block anything.
He did too, I remember.
Yeah, nobody's going to block anything standing in front of him.
And then after that, the second half of this episode is, like we said, our conversation with Latin Dead. And this is Oscar Hernandez, Brenden Tacon, and Pete.
That's right. And then we also had Natalie too, and she had just joined us.
She had actually just learned the music 20 minutes before the performance.
So let's do everybody right. Here they have, okay, because what Latin Dead has done on their Instagram has they started to kind of give a little backstory on everybody who's in the Latin Dead. So Jacob Garcia, he's their singer, and he's an LA native. Then we have Renee Camacho on bass, the groove master. And then Natalie Forteza, she's going to be joining them for the East Coast run. And then there is Pete Nader on the trumpet, who's a Grammy award-winning trumpet player. Of course, everyone knows John Cadlicek. And then, of course, Brenden Tacon on tablas, and anybody else who wants
Grammy
to jump on
award
stage with
winner
them.
Oscar Hernandez.
Yeah.
Yeah, man. So this is a twofer you're getting this week. Sorry we weren't here on Monday, everybody. We were recovering from the Oregon Country Fair, and we will have a full breakdown of what went down at fair on Monday coming up. So stay tuned for that.
Yeah, we weren't here on Monday. We were here, but we weren't here. We were returning. Christ.
It was that. It's a whole thing.
Hey, we're still resting up.
Yeah.
We really, yeah. You know, life is
hard sometimes.
I don't want to say no. Well, of course, life is hard sometimes, but really, life happens at us. You know,
I think we're making that happen.
You know, we are making it happen because we're making No Simple Road happen. And then we also talk about what happens, right? So we make it happen, and then we come back and we plug in the mics and we talk about what has happened. But sometimes we need it to like ruminate in us for a little bit. We really need it to settle.
To figure it out, let it process.
And also 5 days camping, also being at a festival, performing, walking 10 plus miles a day, and then coming home and recording was not happening. It was time for No Simple Road to go night-night.
Yeah, and meeting hundreds of people. Yeah, Aaron's going to name off every person that he met on Monday's show.
First and last name.
That's the thing. We met so many people, and everybody was so awesome.
Okay.
But you're going to hear more about that.
You'll hear about that Monday.
But when we were at Skull and Roses, I just want to say thank you to the entire Skull and Roses crew for bringing us back, for making it possible for No Simple Road to come back for their third year? Second year?
I can't
remember.
It's either third or fourth.
Did we do 3 years of NSR?
We did two.
Okay, we did two.
I think this was four. This is SNR 4.
Because we weren't at the first one. I think we were at the second one.
Right. Anyway.
But, gosh, you just saw, you in real time, you
real
saw
time
that. But
flaking out.
Yeah, no, I just wanted to say thank you because it was such an incredible time. And one last thing I do want to mention is our sister, Jenny, Beadwork by Jenny on Instagram. She is doing a book tour for her book, Speaking in Beads. And today was her first talk and book signing and stuff like that in San Francisco for the last Dead & Company shows. So if you happen to be in San Francisco and you want to see her slash get one of these incredible, beautiful books, please do so. Follow her on Instagram at Beadwork by Jenny and look her up because you will not regret it.
Yeah, this is
a special thing for our
amazing story
family.
And a beautiful human being that has created something really cool. So go check our sister out if you're in San Francisco, like Mel said. Yeah, Mel, thank you, like you said, to the whole Skull and Roses team, to Aaron and Katie and Dennis McNally and Chris and all of you. Thank you so much for being so gracious with Skull and or with No Simple Road and allowing us back to Skull and Roses and having us there and treating us like family and making us feel cozy and warm and happy and
be part
cared
of a,
for
and to be part yeah. of a family reunion. That backstage was just amazing.
Yeah, man. So let's get everybody to these couple of interviews. Let's do the business real quick. Like, we have a couple of calls on the tepid line we're going to do, and then we'll get you all to the interview. So follow No Simple Road, if you don't already, at No Simple Road on Instagram, Twitter, and Facebook. Go to www.nosimpleroad.com. That's where you can get a tarot reading from Mel. You can get No Simple Road merch. You can find out where we're going to be. And you can listen to back episodes of No Simple Road there as well. It's pretty cool. It's like if No Simple Road had a website, that's where you would go. That's what it is. See?
Yeah.
It's the No Simple Road website. It's pretty neat. Hey, if you aren't a patron on Patreon, check this out. There's a new feature on Patreon now. You can sign up on Patreon for nothing, for no money, just to like follow No Simple Road on Patreon without paying anything, and you'll get alerts when we post content.
Oh.
And then you can decide later if you want to become a patron. We are putting up a ton of content on Patreon, and if you aren't part of that No Simple Road corner of the universe, you're missing out on part of your community and a bunch of content. Side Roads is a whole other show that's going on Patreon. We're posting stuff a few times a week up there, different articles and things that we're writing, pictures, there's polls, jokes of the week, and community engagement happening up there, and soon to be videos too.
One of my favorite things is the Side Roads with our listeners. So like if you sign up for Patreon, chances are probably going to get around to Corey interviewing you, so we get to hear your story. I know Cody just did one, and that'll be coming out soon.
Yep,
Mel's can't wait to hear week. That.
Yeah. So that's Patreon, man. You can sign up for as little as a buck a month. And hey, man, let's just be honest. The world is a vampire. No, the world costs money. And that's how we pay for stuff around here at No Simple Road. So if you want to help us out, be part of our community, engage with your fellow heads that are part of the No Simple Road family, that's how you do it.
It's the best way to do it.
Patreon.com/No Simple Road.
And another thing you can do that doesn't cost anything that we ask you to do all the time is go over to Apple Podcasts, hit that 5-star. That's really easy to do, just to be like 5 stars, but then go above and beyond that and leave us a little review. We do not.
Damn.
We did not get a single one for June.
Nobody liked No Simple Road in June
yet. So be that person. Step up, hit that home run, knock it out of the park, and give us a review.
If you're listening on Apple Podcasts right now,
and you haven't
left a review, here's the deal. Please do us a solid and leave us a July review. Please. I'm begging. All right. Please. Pretty please.
Begging you.
All right. There it is. Mel even sang it to me. All right. That's the deal for reviews. Now, we have something else. It's called the Tepid Line.
Ooh.
It's 971-808-1524. That number again is 971-808-1524. And you know what?
Be like David.
Look, here's the deal. I think we're going to have to change the name from the John B. line to the David from California line.
That's the truth. I mean, I'm sorry, John B., but you brought it all the way up until this point, but David is keeping it hot.
He's coming for that title.
Is definitely coming for that title. Let's see if we can do this without.
Hi, No Simple Road. It's Dave from California. I wanted to read you something that I had written a few years ago. And what Aaron said about Mel being a badass reminded me about this. And it goes for Mel. It goes for my wife, and it goes out to all women. It's called Strength Beyond Femininity. Standing like a superhero at the end of each day, strength and courage lie beyond her femininity. She repels attacks on her every day, physical, mental, and societal. Like a mother bear, she will fiercely protect her family. Turning another page, she will love like no other. Passions spilling over like water dropping from a waterfall. Anger her, though, and you are in for every natural disaster rolled into one.
That's juicy.
Happiness lives in her heart, though at times it can be murky. Oh. She hides her fear from the world at times, but she knows it helps shape her, allows her to be her. Mother, wife, daughter, lover, girlfriend, friend, all words to describe not the fairer sex, no, nor the quote-unquote weaker sex. These are the words to describe our warriors, princesses, yeah, doctors, lawyers, astronauts. Anything they wish to be, they can and will be. And I thank you for just being you. So thank you, Mel, for the strength that you have. Thank you to all the ladies in the NSR family for the strength and positivity that you bring. And much love to everybody out there today. I hope everybody in the NSR family and the greater world is having a beautiful, successful, and happy day today. Love you guys.
Oh,
wow,
David. Wow. Okay. Let's just move.
Let's keep going.
Keep rolling.
Hi, No Simple Road. It's Dave from California. I wanted to read you something that I had written a few years ago, and what Aaron said about.
Oh, I screwed up. Hold on. I screwed up. I'm sorry, everybody. I'm going to keep going. I'm not even going to roll back. I'm going to just do this. I'm going to keep playing these.
Hey, NSR fam. This is David. I'm sure you know my voice already. Calling from California, driving these freeways today. Listening to episode number 43 way back in the day.
Whoa.
And
throwback.
I don't know how you guys do it, but you were speaking to me today, literally. A lot of what you said in that episode centered around being yourself and being your true and authentic self. And I just have to say that it was hard to listen to because I don't always feel like I am true to my authentic self. Throughout the episode, my eyes were, I wasn't full on crying, but definitely full of emotion enough that my eyes were tearing through a lot of that episode. And I'm sure you can hear it in my voice now too. It's
you sound great.
You know, I don't know. But thank you for opening my eyes, and I'm going to try and be more.
Aww.
I'm going to try and be more me, because you guys reminded me that it's okay to be me, and I needed to hear that.
Wow. It's not over.
Thank you, guys. I love you for what you guys put out there every week. And you really do. It really does feel like you speak to me personally on these episodes. So thank you. I love you guys. And look forward to the next episode, whether that's an old one or a new one.
Thanks, David. Yeah, you don't even care what it
you
is.
You always let us off the hook.
I love you guys.
Love you
and
too,
I love
man.
The No Simple Road family out there as a whole. Thank you. I'll talk to you again soon, I'm sure.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Hey, man, I'm going to tell you something. All right. First of all, whatever or whoever told you that you weren't okay or that you needed to be something other than what you really are, they are full of shit, and don't believe that shit. You are here for a reason. And what you are and who you are is exactly, just exactly perfect and what this world needed. And that's it. You are allowed to be you unapologetically. As long as you're not being a dick or hurting anybody, be yourself, brother. And don't apologize for it and don't feel bad about it, because it's beautiful. There is nobody else on this planet that is you, period. There's one. Nobody else can do what you do, see what you see, think what you think, or experience what you experience the way that you do it. It's all you. And so it's beautiful. And that expression of the universe that calls itself David is a wonderful thing. And that goes for everybody else out there too. Don't apologize for being you, man.
I just want to say today, you are loved, David, by this crew over here. And I love it when you do this, because I want to go listen to this one now. You said 43.
Yeah, it was the view from the skies as the crow flies. You know, we were just talking about, we were at fair over the weekend, and somebody, I had spoken to somebody that knew Ken Kesey and some of the pranksters back in the day, and they told me, he said, you know, I figured out after a little while of knowing them what their superpower was. And I was like, what was their superpower? And he said, being wholly, totally, and completely unapologetically themselves. That was the superpower of the Merry Pranksters and Ken Kesey. And that energy changed the world. So think about that. Yeah. So that's the tepid line. We got a couple more from David, but I'm going to save them for next week, because you got to save some.
Yeah. Well, I just want to say too, on that beautiful poem that you wrote for your wife and for every woman out there, and thinking of me when you decided to share that, I really resonate with it. I really appreciate it. You're right. We definitely keep our fears hidden, and we have lots of love in our heart. And there's a lot that goes into being a woman and a mother and a daughter and a lover and all of those things. And somebody describing it from the outside really shows the beauty of all of it when it doesn't feel so beautiful all the time. So thank you for saying that and having the mind to write that when you did. And I appreciate every single call that you make, David.
Hell yeah.
It's always insightful. It's always sweet. It's always thoughtful. And I'm glad that we're speaking to you from 5 years ago.
Hell yeah. And hey, you know what? Like, that is how you use the tepid line. And David,
absolutely.
If I had 1,000, not even 1,000, if I had 100 No Simple Road family members like you, this show would be bigger than Joe Rogan. Simple as that. Like, people like that in our corner, that's the shit.
I'll be happy with just you, David. I'm happy with this right now.
Oh.
I'm serious.
David, like, you know what I mean, man.
I'm happy with this.
I am too. That was a compliment.
No, I understand that the things need to grow. And in 5 years, 6 years, No Simple Road has absolutely grown. But the type of growth matters. And when we find people like you, David, that are willing to participate, speak back, give ideas, that means that the show is growing with strong roots
and doing what it's supposed to.
That's what matters.
Yep.
So thank you, David, again.
100%. I just can't wait till we get to meet you in person,
yeah,
David, and hug it out.
Yeah.
It's going to be amazing.
So
shit might explode.
971-808-1524. Be like David. It's all that we have to say about that. That's the business side of No Simple Road Beyond. Tell somebody that you love about the show. We would appreciate it. It means the world to us if you would share the mycelial network that is the No Simple Road family with somebody that you know, love, and care about. And yeah, we're going to take you back in time right now. We're gonna go back in time to April at Skull and Roses on the beach in Ventura, California, backstage with the one and only Bill Walton. Are you ready?
Yeah.
All right.
I'm ready.
I'm ready too.
Without further ado.
I know Bill Walton's ready.
Without further ado, Apple, the No Simple Road crew gives you
Bill Walton. We're good here?
Yes. Boom.
All right. We're sitting here with Bill Walton at Skull and Roses. How you doing?
Yeah. Yay! Woo!
Oh my gosh.
Let's just start yelling.
Never had such a good time in my life before. Where have I been my whole life? Wow. How does the song go? All the things I tried to do but only did halfway. Hey man, today I made it all the way because I made it to Skull and Roses 2023. I came in here sick. As sick as can be, because I'm always sick of something or somebody, but man, I am healed. I am ready to go. And this has just been over the top, spectacular, beautiful, wonderful. What a venue, what a place, what a crowd of people, what a family community, what support, what facilities. You name it, on the beach, palm trees, not a cloud in the sky, cool breezes coming in off the ocean, yeah. Shakedown streak, you got the vineyards over here. It's all happening. If you're not here, you have missed the time of your life because we're having that ourselves.
Wow.
Interview over. Thanks, man. What are we missing? Here's my question. What are we missing? Nothing.
Nothing.
We need more. 5 days is not enough. Last year was our first day. Last year was our first year. Laurie and I came, and we had no idea what we were getting into.
Oh,
and we
really?
Had so much fun. And so we said, okay, we're coming back for 3 days. And so now we're here for 3 days, and we already made the commitment. This is our first day. We already made the commitment that next year and forevermore we're coming for five days.
What? And wow.
We hope all the great people that do this, they expand it maybe for a whole week. I don't know, man, but... Geez, I mean, the people, the joy, the happiness, everything that I found with the Grateful Dead 56 years ago in 1967 in Los Angeles, it's all right here and even more. Just so many cool people, so many happy people, so much love, so much hope, so much optimism, joy, people believing in the future, and it is fantastic. But part of the future is that we celebrate today. And oh my gosh, we are celebrating. Okay, who have we come through here today? Yeah. So I'm just looking at the schedule here. And fortunately, okay, so... David Gans, we saw him early on. He started it off. And then China Cats, incredible. And then High Rider, man, I had never heard
of him. Never heard of him?
Indianapolis.
Never heard of High Rider.
Yeah.
And all of a sudden, they come on the stage, and the revolving stage here is just about the coolest thing ever. And they just, I want to be in charge of the button or the knob.
Aaron wants to know where they go. Aaron had that question. Where do they go?
They go off into a vortex.
No, man, they go off into the ether.
Yeah,
and
that's what I'm saying.
I told you.
So, like, this beautiful place here, right here on the coast of California, Ventura, but just up the road is Ojai. Ojai is the land of the nesting moon. And then you got the lakes up there and the mountains and just absolutely incredible geographic place here with the ocean right there and the breezes coming off.
Well,
and we woke up this morning and opened the window. We got here in the middle of the night. We were at the Clipper game in downtown LA last night. It's a little different there than here.
Yeah, a little different.
It's a different vibe.
Not the Clipper game. The Clipper game was cool as can be. But man, to be out here and all the times we come here to ride our bikes. And I came here in the early 80s, I think, when the Grateful Dead first came here.
That's what I was going to ask you
about. Early 80s. I was there. And we would go to all the shows, you know, growing up in California and being a deadhead from the time I was 15 years old and first heard him. Whenever there was a show.
You were there.
I was there.
What did I never,
Aaron, hold on a second.
Okay. Shut the fuck up.
Are you trying to ask a question?
No,
are you trying to ask
it was a train.
We'll get there. So I never in my life did I ever sit at home and say, you know what, I just think I won't go to the show tonight.
Really?
And I'm so glad that I came to this because it has just been so uplifting and so full of healing energy and so many different things. And one of the things that's remarkable, it's an endless list of remarkable things about this community, artwork and the stickers and the patches and the clothes that people are wearing and the smiles on their faces and the painted faces. And then to be here all day long and from High Rider, which was certainly a high note, and I got to meet them backstage, man. It was very cool. Nick the drummer, and then Blair and Charlie and Eric. And that's all I met.
Midwest guys? Midwest?
Indianapolis, they say. Yeah. Who would have ever thought?
Not me.
But, man, it's just like they were so good. And then it just kept coming all the time. And you got Forgotten Space was very, very good. And then Cubensis.
Oh. Come on,
so,
man.
Cubensis, Ed Fletcher turned me on to – Ed Fletcher's the drummer, and I'm lucky enough to be a prop in one of his bands, the Electric Waste Band.
Yeah.
And Ed Fletcher turned me on to a guy by the name of Nate LaPointe, who is the guitar player for Cubensis. And I didn't know all this stuff. And so one night I was going to be the prop for the Electric Waste Band. We play every Monday night in Winston's in Ocean Beach in San Diego. And I'm kind of a whiner and a complainer, you know.
You seem that way.
I'm always, when the Grateful Dead were going, I would show up with, you know, set lists and notes and venue recommendations and everything. And they said, oh, yeah, Bill, this is really great. You know, and then they kind of take it and throw it away. and if I ever even got just a little bit of a noodle of the song, I would just consider myself very, very fortunate. And over the time, now that's 56 years now, I don't really care what they play anymore.
Right.
I don't really care where they play anymore, although this venue here, they can come back here anytime. But I care that they play it all, and I care how they play. And they're such professionals, and they're such incredible heroes to the world, and the way they come with that shared sense of responsibility and duty and obligation. So here it was. I was there at Winston's in Ocean Beach. We started 8 o'clock on time, we hope. And so here it was that Lori and I come walking in. Lori's my wife, the greatest everything ever. And the song that the song that Jerry's middle finger just closed down there with You Are My Shining Star.
That's good shit, man.
Oh, my.
Shout out Laura, right?
Tears. Lori's my shining star. She's my everything, right? And so I come walking in to Winston's, come in the back door, and they're rehearsing Saint of Circumstance, which is a song that I have been requesting for the Electric Waste Band forever, right? I mean, I love all the songs because it's not really what song it is, it's how they play it. And but playing Saint of the Circumstances. So they were playing it. I was like, oh my God, I've all these years, because I started with the Electric Waste Band as a fan 33 years ago. Maybe, I don't know, 30 plus years ago. And over the years, a fan. And then one day, they needed some help moving some stuff around, so I became a roadie. And then after a lot of years doing that, then one day they said, get up there, Bill. And so I started banging around on some drums up there, and then I became one of the percussionists. And then they gave me a microphone. And then after that, they turned the microphone on.
I was going to say, when did they take it back?
And so here it was. I walk in, Winston's, Monday night, 8 o'clock start. And they're rehearsing Saint of Circumstance in the sound check. And I just light up the way I lit up here today. Because when I walked in here today, I'm coming back from one of the journeys I was on. I walk in to High Rider, and they're playing Saint of Circumstance.
Yeah, I heard
that. And they just tore it up, man. And so I'm just like immediately healed at Winston's with the Electric Waste Band. And I walk over and I climb up on the stage and get my little area. And I'm positioned right next to this new guy who I didn't know. And so I start talking to him, and I find out that his name is Nate LaPointe, and he's a guitar player that Ed Fletcher, our drummer, brought with him for the night. And so I'm talking to him and kind of explaining what I like and try to tell him who I am and everything, try to figure out, you know, how it's all gonna work tonight. And so I start talking about a few songs. And Nate LaPointe, who's a big, tall guy, in a relative sense,
yeah, right?
He leans into me. He leans right into me. Looks dead into my soul, right through my eyes, and he says, Bill, don't worry about a thing. I know all the songs. I know all the songs. And he does. And it was the greatest moment of my life. And I said that from the stage that night during the concert. And that was the greatest moment of my life until today, when I show up at Skull and Roses 2023. And to be so much life here, so much love, so much peace, so much of everything that I believe in, and to see all my old friends.
Beautiful.
And I just go right through them. And Ronnie's right there, and Mountain Girl, and Dennis McNally, and Susanna, and Jay Blakesburg, and Bob Mitkins, and just everybody that we know. And then the Dark Star Orchestra, they're playing later tonight.
Can't wait.
It's gonna be, the whole thing. You know, it's just, and all
I
the
think
stickers.
You're more than a prop, Bill. You're more
yeah,
than
much
a
more.
I'm a prop, believe
you're more than a prop.
I have
sorry.
To I have to tell you,
Dennis,
Bill.
Dennis, I'm either a prop or a plotted or potted plant.
No,
one or two.
Neither.
But people, it's like when I was, you know, playing in the NBA in college. You know, yeah. People knew I was a deadhead, right? And so they would just come up to me and give me stuff, presents and everything. And or they'd leave it on my doorstep. You know, they slide it under the door room of my dorm at UCLA. You know, on the front porch in Portland there, and in Cambridge for the Boston Celtics. And it'd be, let your imagination run wild.
Okay. You never hit it, did you, from them?
It was everything.
From Coach Wooden? Excuse me. To hide the Grateful Dead thing from Wooden?
No, I invited them all the time. Right. One of my great failures. We came really close.
Okay, that would have been
We
big.
Would always ask him to come to the shows, because you see, the Grateful Dead played at UCLA in Pauley
at
Pavilion
Pauley, right.
Every year that we were in college there. They always played in the fall. Saturday night before the season started, so we were all there. It was fantastic. They would use our dressing room. I didn't know them then. I was a fan. Right. I didn't meet them till I went to Oregon and
That's
met
where
them.
We're from.
And, you're from Oregon.
Yeah,
okay,
yeah.
What's the name of this show? What is this show anyway?
No Simple Road.
No Simple Road. That's kind of the way my life has been. So I was giving a speech the other day, a big corporate presentation to a trade association group, that the Industrial Supply Association. They make the stuff that makes the stuff
that
allows us to live, right? All these industrial supply guys, right? And the sponsor of my presentation was a group called, the company's name was Norton. And they make grinding wheels and abrasives, which was pretty appropriate to have them be my sponsor that night. So at the reception the night before, I get to say hi to the people and talk to them and kind of get a feel for the crowd before I get up there on the stage and talk for however long they let me. And so so this guy comes up, really cool dude, right? Glazed eyes, he's ready to go. And he comes up to me and he goes, Bill, so many roads, Bill. And so the light went on, and I had the hook for my speech. And so I went back to my room that night, and I put on So Many Roads repeat, and that just gave me everything I needed to come here today. And from the Clipper game last night in the NBA, they didn't win. Their two best players are injured, but they gave up a heck of a battle. And that's one of the things about you learn from life in this community with the Grateful Dead, is that you do your best and you bring it every single day. Make each day your masterpiece. And with Bill Graham, how we learned that the show's got to keep going on, and what
no
everybody has done right here at the Ventura Fairgrounds. Oh my gosh, this is spectacular. Why can't every day be like this?
Yeah.
So Many Roads. What's the name of your show again?
No Simple Road.
Yeah, no, I've been on
We're
that road too.
Yeah.
No.
Okay. The basketball is, I mean, I have a confession to make. I snuck out last night to watch the Warriors and
The Kings.
The Kings, yeah.
Yeah, no, the Warriors are a great
as
team.
As much as I love music, I had to do that.
No, well, the Kings,
feel better.
The Kings have been playing fantastic. Yeah. And they had the first two games, but the Warriors, the biggest challenge for the Kings, and they're really good, and I'm happy for them. And they're great. Great, incredible fan base. How many years did we go to Cal Expo?
Right.
Oh, my God.
That was my
spot. So the American River, the Sacramento River, the Sierra, Grass Valley, you name it. Oh, listen to this. These guys right here, these guys, they've got it.
Leftover salmon.
Leftover salmon. Yeah.
This is my first time with leftover salmon.
Oh, wow.
This is the good shit right here.
Well,
Apple, what do you got?
Is it true there's a story of you taking
apple.
Larry Bird and McHale to a Dead show?
Did that happen? You're young. If you don't know that, Apple, we did that, man.
Uh-oh.
No. So they asked me. This is a good song, man. What's the name of this song? Now, is this Black Peter?
High Time,
yeah. Okay. Whatever.
It's
all one song.
It's one long song, and it hasn't stopped playing for 30 years.
So Larry and Kevin asked me if they could come with me to the show. And so it turned out the whole team went. There's 12 guys on the basketball team, and 11 of us went. The only guy that didn't go was Danny Ainge. He chose not to go, and that was a giant mistake on his part.
But, I would say so.
Yeah.
Yes.
But, we had a wonderful time, and most of the guys have been back again over the years, and it's just fabulous. It's fun. It's incredibly inspirational, incredibly stimulating, incredibly healing, friendly, loving, and it's communal. It's people coming together to do something to make the world a better place.
Yeah.
Through music, through art, and through community, through their spirit, through your soul, through your mind, and you come in here, now they're playing High Time.
You gotta love it. There's something about taking somebody to their first show, and you took the entire team.
Oh, I don't get that. I
bet he's taken lots of people to their first show.
Yeah, yes, that is.
I try not to take people. I try to take people who want to go, who ask me.
Yes.
If they ask me, I like to come with Lori, and experience the love of the solitude and the privacy and the ability to think and ruminate and meditate and then absorb it all and then just take it out and just let it go. Because my goal in life is to be a human forklift and a human solar panel. You know, forklifts, they lift things and people up and they put them in a better place. Human solar panels, you absorb all this incredible energy and then you invert it and you send it right back out so other people can use it. And so this whole deal to come here, and people know my schedule.
Yeah.
You know, my schedule is kind of follows the Grateful Dead, Dead and Company, now Skull and Roses, and I'm right there, and now No Simple Road. And so just like, come on, No Simple Road. It's where dreams become reality. It's where we come to grow. It's where stuff gets done and where the deal goes down. And the facilities here, the opportunities to explore, to create, to dream, to build, and to adventure, to chase the unknown. And, you know, coming to these shows is very much like playing basketball. It's very much like drinking tequila, you know. It's,
okay.
You just don't really know what's going to happen.
Especially if you do them together.
Oh, my God.
Yeah. Well, you talk about adventure.
So
going
I used to go, you know, I used to play basketball, and I was in the NBA, and we would have games all over, and then the Grateful Dead, somehow they'd be playing in the same city.
Yeah, it's weird, right?
So in those days, you know, the shows start and end earlier today than they used to, and which is fine.
Yeah.
I like to go to bed early. You know, I'm a Southern California boy, and we go to bed early because we know that tomorrow is going to be just fantastic again. Now we're not going to bed early tonight.
No.
I mean, Dark Star Orchestra, they don't start till 8.
They're going to
go all night long, and it's just going to be absolutely fantastic. We'll be under the stars. There's not a cloud in the sky here, and the wind is calming down as the sun is starting to get down to the lower levels, and I'm going to put on a sweatshirt here, and I'm just going to go find a good spot, and it's going to be right there. And that whole sense of purpose that I have in my life, that I look for in my life, and I found that with the Grateful Dead when I was 15. I found it in basketball when I was 8. And the same life lessons apply. And even though I've changed teams, the rosters have changed, the Grateful Dead roster has changed, but it's all still the same. From the very beginning, hope, opportunity, and purpose. And then over all these years down No Simple Roads, down so many roads, pride, loyalty, and gratitude. And that's what I have. And when Dennis, my hero, Dennis McNally, man, he's there, man.
He's all over it.
What's the name of this song? Don't run, this is the Dire Wolf.
Dire Wolf.
Yeah. I am a Dire Wolf.
Thank you, Bill.
Bill, thank you, brother.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
No Simple Road.
Yeah.
Let's go.
Let's go.
Again, the greatest day of my life. Excuse me, Nate LaPointe, but today is
keep making that happen.
What an honor.
These are the good old
Dennis,
days.
Mel, Apple, I'll have a bite, please. Aaron, let's go.
Thank you, sir.
Okay, yeah.
Thank you.
On. Heal on. Inspire on. Lead on. Yeah, Skull and Roses on No Simple Road.
Aww.
Yeah,
and that, everybody, was our friend
Bill Walton, everybody.
Yeah.
The best hype man ever.
He's
for
dope
anything.
Yeah.
Like, get him excited and he's going to promote the hell out of it.
I picture him like at the end of the day, like, yeah. And then I was doing.
Yeah, like it just happens.
Just shuts off.
And then when he wakes up in the morning, and then I was going, like, it doesn't stop.
Yeah. Like, like those little, everybody's just seen them by now. It's like a little pin and it says fun meter and it's like empty and full, right? I imagine what kind of energy this man must have.
He's just, his fun meter doesn't have like the red area or the yellow. It's just green.
It's not in between. Yeah.
It's all green.
Full throttle and then off. Full throttle off.
All right. So let's switch some gears here.
Yeah.
We're still backstage at Skull and Roses.
We are still backstage.
We're
switching
hanging
gears.
Out. But we are sitting down with the Latin Dead. Yeah. Our new friends from Tales from the Green Room from Mount Tam Media as well are with us on this
Dennis,
one.
Dennis, Tammy, and
Augie.
Augie, I'm not sure if your voice was heard, but you were there.
He was there. Yeah, he was hanging
in
around.
Spirit,
yeah.
Chilling with us. So, here we go. You guys ready?
What's up, everyone? It's Joe, and I'm the host of That's Awesome with Joe, a podcast on the newly formed Sound Talent Media Podcast Network. I talk with tons of your favorite artists, managers, touring personnel, and more. Most of the time we talk about music, but lots of the time we end up talking about something completely unrelated. We laugh a lot, do a lot of really stupid things, but also some things that are really informative and interesting. Basically, it's a podcast that I think you should listen to. Obviously, I'm biased because it's my podcast, but I think I might be into it if I wasn't the host. Check it out at soundtalentmedia.com.
I'm ready. Yeah.
Do we need to further ado it?
No, they know. The Latin Dead's coming up. Enjoy this and love every moment.
Oscar, we're back.
We're back. I'm here again.
After your triumphant performance at Skull and Roses.
It's a blast to be here. You know, it's kind of cool to, you know, perform live in front of an audience. And it's a great band, great musicians. Having fun with this project, so looking forward to more.
And we're here with Pete. How you doing, Pete?
Good.
How'd it feel up there?
Felt good.
Yeah?
Yeah.
You know, this scene is different. It's a different animal than you guys are used to, I'm sure.
Totally different. That's kind of what I'm relishing about it, you know? It's very different from the normal, from what we, you know, go through. But, you know, like they say, it's spice of life, right? You know?
Can you describe your scene? Like what you're used to going out there and seeing versus something like what you just went through?
Just saw?
Well, I mean, look, music is music for me, and it's all valid. And the fact that you change the scenery a little bit, you know, it's just positive. That's the way I see it. First and foremost, I'm trying to concentrate on the music, the band, and try to put my heart and soul into it and make sure that that's taken care of, and you hope that the audience is with you. It's kind of early in the day for us, you know. We were hoping it would have been a little later where the audience would have been more, you know, but it is what it is. So I'm enjoying it nevertheless. You know, I'm sure Pete is as well.
Definitely, definitely. But I agree, it would have been nice if we would have played a little later on. Maybe next year, hopefully, if they bring us back, we'll play on the weekend when hopefully there'll be some more people in attendance. But I know a lot of people are watching the live stream, and I've already gotten some good comments. So I'm glad that we were invited.
Yeah.
And I really enjoyed it.
It's after being around this scene of people for over 30 years, it's really great to see them responding to Grateful Dead music played differently. It's very interesting to watch.
You know, as far as I'm concerned, when you hear this, what we're listening to now, no offense, it's great, I love it, but you can't even begin to compare it to what we're doing.
No.
So that's the...
But the beautiful thing is, they can still sing along with the lyrics because we haven't changed it that much that it's, I mean, it sounds different, but they're still able to sing along with the lyrics, and that's a beautiful thing. It makes me feel good that even though we're playing for the first few times for an audience, they're still singing along with us.
Yeah, the music is still very much identifiable. It's not a huge departure. And you know, that was done purposely because we wanted people to identify the concept, you know, as not totally different. And we wanted to respect the legacy of what the music is and what people love all these years about what that concept is with the Dead. So it was all done on purpose, you know. I mean, I think that was my concept in terms of helping to put it together with Brenden and all the guys in the band. So it's a beautiful thing when that happens, and we just keep, we just hope to keep building. You know, this is the very beginning stages of it. So yes, if we keep building, and people, the more they see it, the more they can, you know, feel comfortable and grow into it, you know, with us, along with us as a band, you know.
And it's not always immediately accepted, right? I mean, that's a bit of a challenge.
Well,
I
that's think. Always, yeah, you know, part of when you do something different.
Right.
So
right.
Initially people, you know, it's like when you hear a song, right? And you go, and then after you've heard it a bunch of times, you find yourself, wow, I really like the song. I love it. You know, the concept of what it's about, and it grows on you, and you realize how much you like about that song, you know. So it's kind of very similar, you know.
Has it been a challenge for the two of you to adapt the way that you play to this songbook?
No, not at all. And I just want to congratulate Oscar again and the other arrangers for doing their arrangements in a way where, again, the music is still identifiable.
Absolutely.
But it's still very unique as well, you know. And we have our own road.
Well, we wanted to respect the legacy of what our music is as well. So we'd also like to invite Margot Ray, who you heard.
Hi, guys.
We were waiting for that.
So Margot, as you heard, you know, she's an excellent, great vocalist. I've had the pleasure of working with her on many different occasions. I produced one of her last albums. We just did a great event with Michael Feinstein at the Arboretum in Pasadena with the Symphony Orchestra. So happy to have her on board. Came at the last minute, just because three-day call because our vocalist had an issue with whatever. She couldn't make traveling. But, you know, true professional.
Welcome,
that she
Margot.
Is. You know,
right on.
It was an honor. I didn't know anything about this world. Of course, it was in the periphery. I know all about the Grateful Dead. I know the fans, the devotees, everything. But it was so fabulous to dive into this just like with no net. I'm mixing my metaphors, you know, like, and singing these songs. It was great. And the arrangements just really helped everything get real sticky. Like it stuck.
No,
your
presence is powerful. It was powerful today. I did not know that you were not with the band. But we may never experience this collaboration that we had today with John Kay and you, and, you know, this group of people. So it might have been a special, what we were watching might have been really special. No, hopefully it's going to continue, you know what I mean?
You know what, no doubt, and that's a great point. Sometimes what you're performing, you don't know when it's going to happen again, you know, in terms of the exact people,
the exact
dynamics.
Yes.
So I'm one of, you know, appreciating the moment, and, you know, in a way it's kind of, I mean, I hate to make it like a bigger thing than what it is, but historic in a way.
Uh-huh. No, it's like Newport, or down in with when Janis and them played and Jimi Hendrix. All of a sudden, these kids, they changed the world. It's just like us hearing Grateful Dead being done like this. You know, it could turn a page in this and keep the Grateful Dead thing going. And salsa. I grew up with salsa. You know, with the Johnny Pacheco and everybody, Fania All-Stars and all that.
Cilia.
But your presence and everything was beautiful. When you said, hey, eyes of the world, baby, wake up. That was beautiful.
Well, I mean, just to finish the point off, like with Margot, when this came about that she said she was available to do the background vocals, I said, well, let's try and get one of your songs in. You know what I mean? Because I wanted people to hear her and her, the magic of her as a, she's a
holiday light.
Well, she's her own artist. So the truth is, that was an arrangement that I did for her on her recent recording, and we were able to rehearse it
20 minutes before.
Yeah, yeah.
You know?
Seriously, Margo? 20 minutes.
That's the first time I ever sang these songs was 20 minutes before the show.
Okay,
with the band.
The Janis thing to my mind, when you were singing by yourself, that's what brought it up. I go, people have not seen this or heard it. It's an experience for all of us. You know what I mean? Here.
Yes, the Angel Eyes is on my album, The Roots of Ray, but other than that, no, I've never sung any of these songs before.
I've got to ask you, though.
It was an honor to sit next to John and hear him, and, also Justin, but, you know, just to vibe and listen to that.
John is a virtuoso in his own right.
Gifted musician, yeah.
So him to play with you guys, it was, you know, I'm sure, it's an experience for everybody, you know.
That I'm really tickled about that because, you know, when you cross paths with other musicians, from, you know, even another genre, another world, and you're able to connect. And you know what's beautiful about him? He's so down to earth, and he's so giving, and he's just as gassed as we are to have him, for him to be here. I mean, that's what he expressed to me all the time. He said, man, this shit's amazing. So it's kind of cool, and he was totally present in the studio with trying to get it right and work on all the parts. I just told him today, I said, dude, how do you remember all of that? Because it's a lot of stuff for him to remember.
He knows these songs inside out.
He does.
But just we're doing it so differently that it's exciting for him, you know? Yeah.
I can imagine that for him, after playing it like this all these years, it's something else, you know? But I have to ask you, Margo.
Yes.
You know, you've seen a lot of crowds in your life, right? And this is a very different kind of a scene.
Oh, yeah.
What do you think?
The enthusiasm and the way they connected with the groove was fabulous, whether they knew how to salsa dance or not. They were just like, you can't deny the one.
No.
You can't deny the percussion and the one and the hula hoops, and everybody's got their own vibe. But they were so giving. So I can see how Dead fans are.
And you'll always find an aspect present of an audience going like, trying to figure it out, like, you know, what is this? What am I listening to? I mean, obviously, they know what they're listening to, but in terms of like connecting with all the aspects of this particular concept, it's a stretch. Yeah. Let's be honest. For a lot of people, it's a stretch. So although everybody's heard Latin music, but it's not part of their normal routine. We live and breathe this.
Right.
I've been hearing it since I was a kid.
Uh-huh.
So for me, it's kind of similar the other way around, you know?
Talking about the audience, I had the pleasure of being out there. We all did. Aaron and I had also the pleasure of interviewing Brenden and a couple of weeks ago and hearing about the work he's put into this. The serious work he's been, and pulling you guys in as part of it. To watch Derek, who just showed up at the table, his father, see what was going on and the emotion that was there. I got photos. I mean, it was the emotion of that success and coming together and his daughter.
Well,
you guys brought that to the
thing,
family.
You know, amazing. You mentioned Derek and you mentioned Brenden, and the truth is, this is Brendan's brainchild.
Right.
It all happened because of him. The truth of the matter is, and I'm really grateful to him. Because he's a lot younger than us. So, I mean, he's younger. I can say he's younger. I'm going to say he's a lot
easy
younger.
Now. Easy now.
You don't got to out yourself, Oscar. They're not watching.
So,
Don't out others.
Aaron, can I say one thing? You know, I watched as a child the Santana collaboration, you know, when to come up with Latin rock. You know what I mean? And then I grew up with the salsa music, the Vanya All-Stars, and that scene. And then I just put a little timeline together. It took the African drum that was brought to the Caribbean, to Cuba and to the Caribbean. And then it went to New York where it got mixed with big bands in Harlem. And then it got across the Midwest where it got mixed with bluegrass and blues and then rock and roll. And then Jerry grabbed it and now you guys are grabbing it. And thank you, man. Yeah. It brought
that's
a tear
awesome.
To
nice. Here, here.
To my eye when I heard Franklin's Tower being played through a salsa music, man. Thank you.
There are a lot of tears today.
Here's the thing that I don't know if, I mean, you understand people's connection to music. You just said it. You live and breathe this, right?
Yeah.
This group of people, this is more than music for us.
Absolutely.
This is our family. This is our community. This is where we fill our souls and find ourselves. And my wife is Puerto Rican, and
from the Bronx.
And I always wanted her to get the Grateful Dead. I'm doing air quotes for everybody listening. I always wanted her to get the Grateful Dead, and it never clicked. You guys brought healing to that for us, personally. You connected it for her finally. Because of the Latin connection. And so it's very powerful what you're doing for this group of people.
Speak to them. Wow. Well, after we had Brenden on and you, Oscar, I just, that whole day I was like in tears playing the record over and over and over. I grabbed my little Latin Dead, you know, and I'm driving around dancing around the driveway. And it was something that he's right about. This music brings healing for these group of people. But when you start to change it specifically to a culture, now it's bringing healing to that culture in a targeted fashion. And it felt like it was specific to me, from the Bronx, Puerto Ricans, and this was something knocking on our door. I didn't go knocking on its door. And then to bring it into this, Skull and Roses is very special. It's the only festival of its that's like this, that only one band, 5 days, multiple. So I feel like something is shifting. It feels like a shift. And seeing you up there too was really just such a seeing a mirror up there.
Right.
You
all
know,
right.
Representative.
I'm happy to
a representative. The Miss USA, the Miss Salsa, you know what I'm saying? Bringing these two worlds. It was like the mother up there. Yes, honey, bring it in.
You know what's amazing though?
Honored to be invited. Thank you.
And that's what you just said is beautiful, right? When you think about it, you know, in terms of the effect of the music. And I'll be totally honest, like I always am. That's not really what I'm thinking about when I'm, you know, involved in creating the music. I'm thinking about creating a music that comes from a real passionate place of love and respect for the legacy of the music, of trying to create, you know, beauty and putting it together and, you know, and trying to help make a really good recording. And the one thing I could say, I mean, I really knock on wood, is that all the things that I happen to be involved in, I walk away and I listen to them years later, I go like, shh. That just sounds amazing. So the truth of the matter is, the byproduct of that is the effect that you have on the people who are listening to it.
Yeah, because I don't think I went in going thinking, oh, I want to be spiritually healed today. I mean, I like to think that is my mentality, but the reality is I'm thinking I'm going to have a good time. I'm going to enjoy the show, see some incredible musicians, but the impact is what was not expected.
And by the same token, cool. I'm not saying I want to go spiritually heal somebody with my music.
Yeah, right. Yeah, no. If you set, but if you set out to do it, it's never gonna happen.
Yeah.
You just got to be authentic to the arrangement.
Just to tell you all too, me and Aaron and Mel were out there dancing with our friend Mike, and he turns to us, and we all agree with this. I think the whole crowd does. He goes, "I didn't realize how much I needed the Latin Dead in my life."
Yeah. All right.
I think we could leave it right there, man.
Yeah.
I just want to say one more time, thank you all for what you're doing.
Thank
and
you
I can't wait to see where it goes. And I'm honored to know you.
Well, you know what? Thank Great you, guys. You know, sometimes this here is kind of the lifeblood of what we do.
Right.
And I know. So I thank people who meet us halfway and go beyond halfway to express, you know, the effect that the music has. And that's what I live by. I tell people it's not about the money. I make the money and I spend it. It's about after the shows, I'm there and people are coming up to me going like, oh my God, this is some of the best music I've ever heard. And when you're dealing with good musicians who are on the same page, who have the same agenda, same respect, the same love, the same passion, that's what happens. And that's what it's about for me. When you get that type of reaction, you go like, wow. You know, it doesn't get better than that. So thank you guys for supporting the music.
I got you, man.
And for myself. As they say in español, gracias de corazón por el apoyo. Aquí estamos a la orden. Gracias.
Gracias.
Thank you. Bye-bye, guys.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you.
The Latin Dead.
Yay.
Woo! Make sure to go follow Latin Dead on Instagram and check out their website for their tour information and go buy some of their merch because they do have some of the coolest merch.
They have great merch
on the planet.
every bit of their merch is just gorgeous.
Well, just really quickly, they will be, the Latin Dead will be at the Brooklyn Bowl in Brooklyn, New York on July 26th. They are going to be at the Brooklyn Bowl in Philadelphia on July 27th. They're going to be at the Met in Pawtucket, Rhode Island on July 29th.
I like that name, Pawtucket.
And then Park City Music Hall, July 30th in Bridgeport, Connecticut. So any of those East Coast shows, go catch them the 26th through the 30th.
Get ready to get your salsa Grateful Dead spinner groove on.
Yeah, hear it like you've never heard it before and dance your booty off.
And here's the thing, that like if we could put like a bow on this episode, go to Skull and Roses next year, man.
Skull like, and simple Roses. As that,
go to Skull and Roses. There is a lot happening. If you are a Deadhead or Grateful Dead adjacent fan, this is the spot that you want to be in April next year.
And you'll be missing beach. It by then. The tour is going to be over by then.
True.
You're going to be like, where's my and Dead? I want to do something Dead inspired, Dead centric. Skull and Roses next April.
And Skull and Roses carries that. I just saw Cody today and he was talking about being at the Gorge, the end of this Dead and Company thing. It still carries that. It like Grateful Dead shows, Grateful Dead lore is like your grandma and grandpa's house. It's like going to your most comfortable place, being comforted, old smells, nostalgia,
patchouli body odor and pine bud.
Yeah. And Skull and Roses carries that same thing, that the whole feel of it, the hallowed grounds that it's on. It's just amazing. You don't want to miss it.
Nope.
Don't
so
miss it.
Everybody, we will be back on Monday with our recap of the Oregon Country Fair. And please don't miss this. We've done a lot of things in our lives.
And this is different.
And this was very different than anything we've ever done. And each one of us had our own experience.
It was huge.
Fair. And
yeah,
I think
we did.
I think collectively we had a collective thing that happened for us, but each one of us is going to tell our tale of what happened to us at Fair. And
yay,
Apple has a good story for y'all.
And we all do. I've noticed all of us like this week kind of recuperating. I feel like Trey. I find myself just staring off at the tree, like up into the ethers, like collecting memories and making sense of stuff. So having this much time to kind of right, Fredo Fooble. Oh, so yeah, you're gonna hear lots of cool things coming up.
We love you guys, and wait, there was supposed to be something new added in at the end.
I just you're thinking, all of those that are down in San Francisco for these final shows, have the time of your life and call the Tepid Line. Give us a trip report. We're missing out. We want to know about it.
Don't you remember when we were at Fair, I said there's at the end of the show when we do safety third, there's something that I was going to say every time from now on.
When we were standing there looking at the whiteboard by the kitchen.
Yeah. You don't remember what it was?
No.
I have a picture of the whiteboard of the kitchen that I can pull up.
Okay.
Maybe we can pull it together or figure it out
by
Monday.
Yeah. We'll be back next week on Monday with a recap with more stuff and things. Until then, take care of each other, man. Smile at a stranger. Safety third. Hydrate. And
love yourself.
And if you're at Dead and Company, have a dance for us. Hold somebody's hand and look at them and go, listen to No Simple Road and let's boogie to this Althea that's going to happen for sure at this show. We love you guys. We'll see you next week. Peace. Shattered.
mechanism as well as a fear. We've traveled this road before, so we may think, but it's a tad bit of strange similarities that feed an A equal A complex. The fears of your past do not equal the perplexities of the current road.
Yes, we're out there, everyone. I'm Hal Schwartz.
And I'm Flynn McClain. Together, we host None But the Brave, a podcast dedicated to the music and career of Bruce Springsteen.
Bruce and E Street Band are on tour right now for the first time in 6 years, and we're taking a detailed look at what's happening on stage in our bi-weekly episodes.
We've also been recently joined by some very exciting guests, including rock journalist Warren Zanes and Stephen Hyden, Backstreet's magazine founder Charles Cross, and Barstool's Kirk Menahan.
If you're a diehard Springsteen fan, this is the show for you.
So please subscribe to None But the Brave on your favorite podcasting platform, and we hope to see you further on up the road.
Thank you so much! We'll be seeing you!